Hello and welcome to episode 6 of Let's Play Civilization 3. So we're picking up where we last left off. We had declared peace with the Persians. So the Persians are now going up here to attack. I think that they are at war with Rome and China. Yes. And the Romans are sending their reinforcements through here. So I don't know who's gonna get there first, so it should be fun. I think the Persians have an advantage because they're a little bit closer. What I'm doing right now is I'm just building up my forces. We can control G here to get the grid up. So if we park our units here, we can basically one turn attack their capital city. I don't have a lot of money right now. I did think about looking at Persepolis, but I'll do that before I attack. It's about 45 gold, so I can should be able to afford that. Oh yeah, I was a bit bummed out that this is gonna take longer than I hoped it would. Let's move this to here. Oh no, we're gonna lose food. Once they finish, I'm going to mine this to get an extra shield. Oh, it looks like they're actually going to cross through here to attack the Roman force. So we might actually see the fight go on in between our territory. There are the Romans. One of the things I used to do. Oh, I forgot I'm still at war with the Zulus. One of the things I used to do. Okay, finally got my bank back up. Coliseum next. Was to run a debug game, and what a debug game is, it basically lets you watch the game. Watch the AI play itself in the game. And it's a lot of fun because you get to see how the AI thinks, the priorities it takes sometimes, things that you don't agree with necessarily, but they're mostly interesting things because you get to know the AI slightly better. What can we do? Make one. Yeah, we lost our spices, I think, because we declared war on the Zulus. And I'm not quite sure. This one needs a lot of work. Okay, we got that road built. I'm gonna move them over here. Okay, they're finally turning north now. We called your bluff there. They could have declared war on us. Let's build walls for Houston. Looks like we're getting maximum production from this city. What I need to do now is to fix up my roads here, because the next war I'll need to be able to move my troops quickly up and down along this corridor. I can't rely on any links that are on this side of the river because they're likely to move in and pillage, but I can defend these links in the back here a lot quicker. So we made peace with the Zulus. Added that city there. And even from just the growth that we're getting from all these conquests, that I need to just keep building pikes just to defend it because it's a little bit exposed. These units here are the Roman Legion. I think that's the Roman unique unit. I'm gonna have a look at them to see how they compare. Oh, here are the Chinese. Here they come. Let's build a harbor here. Evil infantry. Trying to find a way to irrigate up here. without messing up my current irrigation. Okay, let's upgrade that. Build some trebuchets here. What does longbows give me? Longbows give me 4 attack. 1 kid that can't defend very well. They're almost as good as medieval infantry. Yeah, but they just can't defend and they get too bombard, so they're good. I'll use them. Coliseum, because I need the happiness. Can I talk to anyone for trades? Not well liked. I didn't really play this as a diplomatic game. I kind of went warmonger early. It's probably a bit of an understatement there. Much as I want to build the pork a marketplace, I need to build more pikes to defend that city, because that's the first city they'll hit when they come back down when I attack. Okay, that's my stack of doom right there. Fortify all. Yeah, we're strong against China. Average against Persia. Rome. Average. Okay, so finally gonna check out these legions. I think there are three. Yeah. So they're 3 attack, 3 defense versus 4 attack, 4 defense for medieval infantry. So in Civ 3, because the units have separate attack and defense stats, the AI likes a lot of these type of units. The units that can both attack and defend really well, because then they just build one unit, they spam it, and that's all they do. Oh wow, Chinese lost their city. You'll sometimes see me do this. I toggle down to science as the research nears completion. Oh no, I don't want to do that. What I'm doing is I'm just ramping down the research to get more money for the final turn. Because the way science works in this game is there's no spillover. So if let's say a science costs 500 points, and you, because of your per turn, because of your per turn income, you maybe put in 560, the last 60 science just goes away. So it pays to kind of ramp down your science on the last few turns. That immortal killed 2 legionaries. That's insane. I think the Romans are gonna head north here to take over the city. And the Chinese too are gonna attack the city. Okay. Let's do a courthouse. Now let's do... do some longbows here. We're 1 turn from completing. Okay, we're fine there. How many turns? 12 turns from that. Syracuse fell to the Persians. Not a good idea to be fighting units encamped on mountains because they get 100% defensive bonus. Big picture. I don't think we got any saltpeter in our territory. You need those to upgrade to muskets. Oh, there's one there. Oh. Well, we are strong against Babylon. Going to attack the Babylonians first. I'm going to take some of these rank 3 pikes out to level them up. There's another rank 3 here. Taking all the longbows. Oops, I think I took the pikes too. You're back in. There has to be a better way to do stack movements. I think there's a... I'm doing Control J, but it's every... I have to do it every time I try to move a different stack. I'll have to look that up. Okay, so leaving all the pikes and a couple of horses to defend. And then these guys will go here. Oh, I've got a new pike. I'm gonna merge them into here. This might actually work out to my advantage because that's going to give me time for Leo's workshop to complete, and then I can mass upgrade my all fortify the pikemen. We'll move all of these. Okay. So we're going to attack the Babylonians now. We'll take these three cities here. They're not really rich cities, but it's also good strategically because then we'll surround the Celts. Their cities here will then just be, well, I guess Shantung won't be, but Intombe, this city here will be cut off in Nemassus. And once we get our, oh, there's also a saltpeter here. We'll get that from a peace treaty. Although I don't like its location next to a volcano. They've made peace. working on a road system here. Oh, we do have a saltpeter. I didn't see it. Okay, that's good. I think we're still gonna attack the Babylonians. They're a good target. Persians are a bit scary right now with your immortals. I know immortals are quite popular with players too, with Civ 3. That's their unique unit, their go-to unique unit. Let's see if we can rope the Celts into the war against the Persians. Oh wait, yeah, I forgot. You can't do one-sided wars here, so we'll not do that. Let's go back to trades. There's a bug in this game where if your trade route is accidentally broken, the AI will treat it as a broken deal, even though it's maybe not your fault and you may not be even aware that the trade route will be broken by declaring war. So that's one of the problems with Civ 3, is a lot of the mechanics are not clear. And this was because it's a really early version of a lot of the, or an early implementation of a lot of these mechanics. So it's challenging. Okay. Let's build. You can also see all these red shields and red currency. That means that there was a corruption, so you need to build a courthouse to eliminate it. And it's one of the features that people didn't like very much in Civ 3. And I also forgot that this game doesn't have multi-core support, so I can't like tab into a screen, a graph, chart a screen while the game is running in the background. Okay, so Persia is not at peace with everyone, which is not great. City. Okay. What I'm doing now is I'm building a stack of attacking units here in reserve in case the AI decides to declare war on me. And I don't know which city they'll attack, so I'm just going to put them back in reserve. The good thing about this war is now the Persians have units up here, and then they have to split their forces defending their northern border and their southern border. So we won't, their attack might come from, well, both sides, which is a bad thing. It also means their forces are slightly more split. Okay. Let's see here. Let's build a harbor. Oh, that's a mistake. I guess I can't go back. To attack next turn. I don't like that they spike up, they park all these units here. Let's move up a pike. Okay, now we're gonna talk to move up another pike. Oh, these workers got slept by mistake. I meant to have them build a road. Okay, so Sound the Babylonians. They have nothing to give us, so we're gonna demand something they will never accept. War on them. I'm watching this very closely. I don't like order moving your units. The Leonardo's workshop that we've worked so hard for. And we have no backup plan. I don't think we have another wonder to build on that city. We were three turns away, too. Well, that's a bummer. Can we build anything else? Nope. It's a wasted thing. Yeah, sure, we'll just build a cathedral there. Yeah, I'm just playing this game really badly right now. I mean, on Regent, it shouldn't be this hard. Get our saltpeter connected up. Defenders. At least three. Okay, there's four. At least four. There's four of them. I got lucky there. They sent a pikeman to do something to the city, but I think because they were probably not doing well financially, they disbanded that unit. Okay, I'm gonna move this to block their obvious attack. Resting up. across to fight this. Just have to be very careful with the movements here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to selectively upgrade pikemen from frontline cities into muskets. They're kind of expensive. And I was counting on Leo's workshop to get me a cheap upgrade, but that's not going to happen now. Thank you. I mean, it's kind of bad, but a really effective strategy in Civ 3 is because when you take over a city, there's a lot of unhappy. Well, first of all, you can see here, it says that their nationality is Babylonian, so the game remembers what nationality they were before they were taken over. So they're less likely to be happy if they're at war with you, the citizens. So it's actually a really effective strategy to just starve them to death and keep the city, but you starve the population down to a really low amount. And you take, it's basically genocide. I've never been too comfortable with that aspect, but it is mechanical. Wow, I just lost an elite. I was saving that to farm great peoples, but there jeez. The RNG in this game can be brutal. Okay, I think this is not well defended at all. I'm gonna take this city and call it an episode. I don't know where I want to go after this. I guess get a redo. Don't know if I want any of these cities here. I think Akkad might be good. It'll put us right next to Babylon. But we don't want to get too far up here because then we'll be bordering the Celts. We want to keep a buffer. Cities are also good. I was considering these cities, but it's hard to defend because you're basically surrounded by the Romans and the Persians. We'll see what we can get from the Babylonians. But before we do that, let's continue bombarding. Do they want peace? Okay, they want straight peace right now because we haven't hurt them that much yet. So, okay, thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.